Recording is in progress. So today is part two of tax strategies. Last time we used, we did the taxes straight from my accountant. And today is less technical and more, you better check with your accountant before you do any of this to make sure you can deduct it. Because this is more Zan's beliefs in taxes as a lifetime of paying too much taxes and a lifetime of studying tax laws to see what I really don't have to pay. So let me start you off with sharing the screen, and we will I'll pop in and out for a few minutes because I have to bring other people in. So we're talking about tax strategies. And I urge you to go back and look at last week's event, because we did tax strategies last week, is recorded. And these are strategies. And last time I talked about it, department stores give you a coupon. If you bring this coupon in, you don't pay as much as people who just walk in off the street. And taxes are exactly the same way. The IRS says, look, you don't have to pay all these taxes if you bring the right coupons. And as realtors, you have taxes that are, or tax strategies that are created just for your business. And you can do things that normal people off the street cannot do. So tax strategies is something that you really want to pay attention to, because if you don't, you're probably paying too much in taxes. So this is Joyce Armstrong. She is a lady that started doing my taxes when I was 20 years old. And she told me, she said, Zan, a small business is the greatest tax shelter in the world. And in real estate, everything you do is a business expense. She said, everywhere you go, everything that you do, everything that you do is something that's deductible or something that's considered an expense in real estate. So, I mean, just think about it. You go to the grocery store, you meet somebody, somebody that you know well. How are you doing? Oh, we just got a job transfer. We need to talk to you about selling our house. Now, is that trip to the grocery store a business expense? Heck yeah. The only reason you were there was to see those people and gain that listing, and you get a commission. Where did that commission come from? It came from the grocery store. I always tell the story of Mitchell Graham, who was a great realtor in our town. Every day I would leave my office. I'm about 300 yards away from the Harris Teeter grocery store, and I'd walk in the grocery store, and there would be Mitchell Graham in the fruits and vegetables with a shopping cart talking to somebody. And I'd go by, hey, Mitchell, how are you doing? Hey, Zan. And then I'd go do my shopping. And when you check out, I could look back down into the fruits and vegetables, and Mitchell is still down there talking to somebody else. And finally, one day I said, Mitchell, dude, are you coming to the grocery store to shop, or are you coming to the grocery store to sell real estate? And he said, don't tell. It's too easy. The fun part was our another buddy realtor of ours had bought the baby butt advertisements, you know, where you fold out the cart and you put your baby's butt on the little plastic thing. He had bought the ad in that grocery store for you to put your baby's butt on. Mitchell was making money by standing in the back. So everything that you do is a business expense. Now, we got to figure it out from there. So let's start. First of all, it sounds real simple. Keep your receipts. If you spend money on your business, keep those receipts. I had lunch with a buddy of mine the other day. We finished lunch. They brought the thing. He paid with a credit card. He was finished. He took his phone and clicked. And then he wadded up the receipt and threw it away. And I know what he was doing. He has a piece of software that he and his wife use that feeds those receipts into an accounting software, and it automatically says this is a business expense, and there's a copy of the receipt. Now, he also did a little of this, and I know what he was saying, lunch with Zan Monroe, business expense. That means it's a business lunch. But if you have that lunch and you don't write on the back of the receipt, lunch with Zan Monroe, or what you talked about, it's not deductible. Just a receipt, the IRS is going to go, wait a minute, you got a receipt here. It doesn't tell me anything. Well, that was with Zan Monroe. Doesn't say Zan Monroe anywhere on the receipt. On the back, all you have to do is write, lunch with Zan Monroe, learned about, you know, ching, ching. Now, what's that deduction? So if you save your receipts and you go to lunch, now you get to deduct. My food costs me half of what your food costs because I deduct it. If you are late from work, if you are working late, let's say you're showing property till 6 or 7 or 8 o'clock at night, and you stop by and get fast food on the way home or order food and pick it up, that is deductible. See your accountant. It's deductible because you couldn't cook dinner for your family. You had to pick food up. Got me? It's deductible. And you get to deduct half of the food. Listen to me, 50% of the food. Now, the IRS said, look, you had to eat anyway. But if you keep the receipt, so if you spend $50 on a meal or $100 on a meal, half of that is tax deductible, which means it comes off your earned income and you don't pay tax on that amount. The more you have, the more you get to deduct. Are you eating business lunches on a regular basis? The answer is yes, every day. Don't ever go eat alone because you can't deduct that. But you, well, let's think. If you were working and emailing or typing or calling while you're eating lunch, you might be able to write it off. But the truth is, you should never eat alone. You should always eat with friends. You should always eat with people who you consider clients. And is everybody that you know a client? And the answer is, yes, it is. Set aside to the PowerPoint. Now, travel, business travel. Do you ever travel for business? Here's what Joyce Armstrong taught me years ago. She said, Zan, if you go to another town, do you ever stop in a real estate office? I said, yeah, all the time. How's the market? Do you ever pick up a brochure and a business card while you're there? Bingo, it's a business trip. Oh, you mean if I'm going to the beach and I wanted to learn about what the market is at the beach? Yes. If you're going to the mountains? Yes. If I'm going to Alaska? Yes. You with me? Now, I'm a speaker. So when I go to Alaska and I actually speak, yes, that is a business trip. But if you drive 100 miles from home and you pick up a business card, well, then it's a business trip. Let me let some people in. Sorry about that. It really helps when y'all show up on time. That way I don't have to be picking up and stopping and starting business travel. So check this out. When you travel, 50% of your food is deductible. Got that? We learned that in the last screen, right? Check this out. Your hotel is 100% deductible. Your hotels are 100% deductible. So the cost of a hotel on a business trip is 100% deductible. The cost of food is only 50% deductible. What if you order room service? That comes through as a hotel expense. See your accountant. But if it's on the hotel bill, it's 100% deductible. If it's a food receipt, it's 50% deductible. Y'all work out your own thing. Now, have you ever taken a cruise and wished you could write it off? Do they ever teach continuing ed or events on a cruise ship? I have spoken on 4 different cruises over the last 20 years. The great state of Kansas has taken me cruising to the Bahamas, to Mexico. And guess what? I am the business expense for all those people on the cruise. Once that ship leaves port, then the part of the cruise that is you have to attend is deductible. See your accountant on how to account for this. But I have friends that all every time they do CE at sea, this I can take my continuing ed at sea, they do it because it's deductible. And can you clean your clothes? See, what the IRS says is, I can't take this shirt to the cleaners and go, I needed to clean my shirt, therefore it's a business expense. Doesn't work. If I'm on a trip and I have to wear this shirt tomorrow in a meeting and it gets stained or soiled and I leave it and get it cleaned at the hotel or while I'm traveling, that is a business expense because you needed that shirt. You only had one. See your accountant. Today's a little further out on the hairy edge. Oh, by the way, do you have a uniform? Uniforms are deductible. The cost of the uniform is deductible. The cost of cleaning that uniform is deductible. Do you wear a uniform to work? What about those logo imprinted shirts? See your accountant, because if you're buying a t-shirt that says Zan Monroe, the world's greatest real estate agent, or you know whatever your company name is, might be. Let's see, I've got some chat going on here. What if my uniform... I always like Dave Stepik. He always comes up with the greatest question. If my uniform is the same suit, shirt, and tie, I don't think the IRS is going to buy that one, buddy. But if your accountant says do it, I'm all for it. I love Dave. I can always count on you for something out of the box. All right. So let's talk about your car. Automobile use in your business is absolutely deductible. So here's the first question. Is it owned by your business? If you have incorporated, you may want to consider having a corporation purchase a vehicle. And that vehicle is used for what? It's used for business, only business, all the time business. But if you haven't incorporated, see your accountant, should your business buy a vehicle. Okay. Now, a little thing here. Your vehicle is tied to your homeowner's insurance. And we learned this lesson last year. If you can tie your auto insurance and your house insurance together, you reduce your premium considerably. So you may want to look into that because for some reason we got ours not connected and we were paying too much in homeowners insurance or car insurance. Second thing about your vehicle is, do we do mileage or actual expenses? See your accountant. Last time I asked about this, they said, whatever you start with this vehicle is what you stay with this vehicle. So if you started with mileage, you know, you're deducting the IRS per mile, whatever discount they give you. Great. You got to stay that way as long as you own that vehicle. If you use actual expenses, then we stay with that. Whatever you and your accountant decide there is best. Now, one thing that the IRS is looking for is a mileage log. And someone told me in a class I was in not long ago that they had an app on their phone that tracked every mile for business that their car moved and they didn't have to write it down in a little log. That's great. But all the IRS actually wants is a 30-day window, and you can say times 12. Now, if you're going to do a 30-day auto log on your vehicle, what months would you use? I would use my busiest month, which would be May or April, or you know your marketplace better than I do, but I would definitely use the busiest month of the year. And then we come to an interesting point that my accountant and I played with. It's called the first call of the day. So my accountant said, now your deduction for mileage begins after you arrive at work. The IRS will not allow you to deduct the mileage to work. And I didn't like that. And so I began to argue with her. I said, but I don't always go to the office. Think about it this way. Lots of times in real estate, you leave home, go pick up a client, and you're, so is traveling to pick up the client deductible? She said, nope, it's at your work. I said, so who determines when I'm at work? And she said, well, the IRS has rules. You got to drive to the building. I said, but I don't work in a building. I work from a phone. What if my first phone call is in the driveway while I'm sitting in my car and the car is idling? Can I then deduct every mile my car moves? And my accountant reluctantly said, you know, I like that idea. So call logs, we used to get them with our phone bill. Your call log will tell you when you made your first call of the day, if you're ever challenged, but see your accountant first. Don't do anything based on what I'm telling. So, let's see what other fun stuff I can get y'all into today. Office supplies. I am sitting right here in my office. I have papers. I have folders. I have a calendar. Yes, I'm archaic. I still carry a paper calendar. I have cell phones. I have postcards that I bought actually on a trip when I was in Alaska. Note cards, papers, pens, products, all of that you have to run an office. And quite frankly, if you don't have office supplies, the IRS is probably going to go, wait a minute, time out. You have a completely paperless office? Now, I know some people that go paperless, and that's fine if y'all want to do that, but it just doesn't work for me because Zan's a scribbler. I have to scribble down. So papers, pencils, copies, printers, computers. There's a printer right over here on the desk. The computer that I'm using to do this event with. These are all office supplies. I don't own this computer. My business owns this computer. Cell phones. This is not a personal cell phone. This is a business cell phone. The number on this phone is the number you'll find online. If you want to talk to Zan, you dial this number. I love it. A lot of times people call my number and they go, oh, you answer. I expected an answering service or a secretary. I was like, no, it's my phone. That's why it is. This cell phone is not owned by me. It's owned by my business. Without the internet, I can't do what I'm doing right this moment. I cannot sit here and talk to y'all without the internet. So is the internet a business expense or a household expense? Maybe I have my own internet channel here in the house with my own router. And therefore, it is absolutely 100% only used for business. And therefore, it's deductible. Parts of your home are quite deductible. I'm sitting in my home office. And when we began this renovation, the accountant said, oh, that's your home office in there? I said, yeah. He said, all the renovation is a business expense. Okay. Did you know that if you have a home office, let's say you have 1,000 square foot home. I'm doing this so it's real simple for Zan. You have 1,000 square foot home. Y'all can't see that. 10% of it is my home office. All right. 10% of the expense of running my house is now deductible. The property taxes, the insurance, the capital improvements. Now, your heat, lights, power, water, see your accountant. Now, let's talk about your home office for a minute. It must be an office, not a bedroom with a desk in it. If so, you can deduct the space of the desk, but you can't deduct the whole room. So what the IRS is looking for, what's in the closet? If in the closet are your clothes, you can't deduct the whole room. If in that closet are all your paper products, supplies, all that sort of stuff, yep, it's a home office. Home office means an office in your home. I remember being a child and my Aunt Lou and Uncle Dean had a home office. And I just thought that was the coolest thing ever because I had never seen one before. And it was very rare. They ran their businesses out of their home. Today, like 25% of the U.S. population works from home, but you've got to designate that area. It's got to be exact. All right. Now, I want to talk a little bit about your house, and next time we're going to do this in depth. I want to talk about paying off your house, because people always, when I start talking about paying off their house, they go, but Zan, I get to deduct the interest. Okay, that's fine. Let's say this year you spend $1,000 on interest on your home. How much will that save you in your taxes? It goes against your earned income. You spend $1,000 on interest. Principal is not deductible. Interest is. All right. So you paid $1,000 in interest. It's deductible. What tax rate are you at? 30%? Guess what? You just saved yourself $300 in taxes. Now, let me get this right. I'm going to spend $1,000 to get $300 back. Spend $1,000 to get $300 back. I'll make everybody a deal. Send me a check for $1,000. I will send you a check for $300. Let me give you my mailing address so you can do this today. Don't wait. Send me a check for $1,000. I will send you immediately. I will send you a check. But I might even put in a Starbucks gift card. You send me $1,000. I'll send you $300. How many times a day will Zan do that? As many times a day as I can get people to do it. It doesn't make any sense, does it? So, I'm right on time. I'm going to leave you with this last thought. Realtors have special tax strategies. They're only compared to like farmers. Oh my God, farmers have fabulous tax strategies. And preachers have even more spectacular tax strategies. So if you want the best tax strategy in the world, you need to become a farmer who's a preacher, who's also a realtor. I'm Zan Monroe. It's been fun today. If you got any questions, let's drop them in the chat box. I'm going to stop the recording, and then I'll stay and...